Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick here, back in the U.S. of A, of course. by the grace of God, going where the Lord would lead me to go, doing what the Lord would want me to do. Blessed be His name. Hallowed be His name. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. He is my rock, the God of my salvation, the captain of my salvation, the author and finisher of our faith. He is the first born among many brethren, brothers and sisters. He is the Messiah. He's the Savior. He's the leader. He's our Lord and our God. He's our King of Kings and our Lord of Lords, brothers and sisters. Now, back in the beginning, God was the King of His creation, and He gave Adam and Eve one command, brothers and sisters. He said, you can do anything you want, eat any food you want, but do not eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Adam and Eve had one commandment, brothers and sisters, don't eat from that tree. As a matter of fact, it wasn't a positive commandment. You must do ABC. It was a commandment of just don't do this one thing. But they disobeyed the one commandment, brothers and sisters. They were beguiled by the serpent, and they did fall, brothers and sisters. And since that time, all have been under the curse of the fall of Adam and Eve, brothers and sisters. We are living in the fallen world. As I said in the last video, what God started out is, you know, in Genesis, in the garden with God, ended with in a coffin in Egypt. The last Bible verse of Genesis is in a coffin in Egypt. What God started is something beautiful, something awesome, something perfect. Man walking with God in the cool of the day in the Garden of Eden in the perfect world. No death, no sin, no sickness, no disease, no bad news. No satanic kingdom there, no wars, no rumors of wars, no famines, no pestilences, no earthquakes, no diseases. That man was walking with the Father in the cool of the day. How great is our God, and how awesome and great is the opportunity that God gave man. Brothers and sisters, Adam and Eve sinned, against the Lord, and the Lord was rejected. They rejected the Lord as their king. And then God came along later on with Abraham, and He set Himself up that He was king over Abraham. And king was obedient, and Abraham was obedient to God. As the Bible says, brothers and sisters, as I've mentioned in the last video, the devil has as above, so below, with the Baphomet symbol, you know, and you see these movie stars doing it, one hand up and one hand down, even a statue of George Washington doing that up there in Washington, D.C., wearing a toga, half naked, as above, so below, as the devil's plan. But then God also tells us, let thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. God told Moses, make the things on earth as a pattern after what you see in heaven. So, brothers and sisters, Abraham walked as a king in the world, and God was a king over him. Abraham went forth as a king conquering. He delivered, he had an army. He delivered in two different times. He delivered and made war and had victory. He delivered his nephew from captivity of these four kings versus the five kings and all these things that Abraham did. He was as a king among the people, as God was a king above him. Same thing with Isaac. Same thing with Jacob. Brothers and sisters, when Jacob's sons, their sister Dinah was raped, they went and which they shouldn't have done, and embarrassed Jacob, and they tricked those people in that town that if they would be circumcised, then they would join together and be one people. And they waited till after they circumcised themselves, and while they were still in pain in the first days after their circumcision, they went there and killed everybody, brothers and sisters. And then, there was all the people in that area were all related. You know, there was like a nation of people, tribes of people. And then they were, you know, Jacob said, they'll come and kill us. You know, so what Jacob did, he told them, drop all your idols, drop all of your, you know, your jewelry, all of these earthly wealth that's a pattern after what Satan wants you to have. You know, all these foreign gods and all of these things as above, so below from the second heaven, from Satan's principalities and forces of darkness in the second heaven. Drop all those things, bury them under this tree, and let's go up to Bethel. Bethel, house of God. Bethlehem, house of bread. You know, Bethel, house of God. Bethlehem, house of bread. Just to let you know, Jesus came from the house of bread. David was born in the house of bread, another earthly king. and then Beth-El is a house of God. That's the same place where Jacob had his dream of Jacob's ladder, as they talk about. You know, he saw angels ascending and descending there, and he said, surely God's in this place. So he changed the name of the place to Beth-El, house of God. So he took his children, had them purify themselves, lay down their worldly things, repent, and go up to the house of God. And then it says in the Bible that a fear fell upon all those people, the relatives and the other members, you know, the other towns that belonged to that same tribal group, where they killed all the people and tricked the people, two of the sons of Jacob. And the fear fell upon the people. Why? Because they went to the King of Kings, the king over Jacob, over Israel. You know, Jacob's name was changed to Israel. Israel and Jacob is the same person. Jacob is before he was really born again, and before his conversion, when he wrestled with the Lord and had his hip damaged by the angel of the Lord, had his name changed to Israel. He who wrestles with God and man and overcomes. Brothers and sisters, the nation of Israel will one day wrestle with man, with God, and they will overcome one day. They've been wrestling with God. They wrestle with God to obey the Ten Commandments. They wrestle with God to, you know, with idolatry. They wrestle with God to accept Jesus as the Messiah and as their king. They wrestle with God to accept God is their king, and they rejected him and wanted King Saul. They've wrestled with God. They've wrestled with God. They wrestled with man. They wrestled with men that day when Jacob's sons killed the people. They wrestled with men with Isaac over the wells. They wrestled with men when they dealt with the Romans and the Greeks and all the Babylonians and the Medo-Persians. They wrestle with men today. Israel is a thorn in the flesh of all the Muslims. They hate Israel. Right today, Israel is wrestling with man. Right now, since their rebirth, they wrestle with man when they deal with Hitler. They're wrestling with man right now in the Middle East. And they're wrestling with God right now because they won't accept Jesus as their King of Kings and Lord of Lords. But Jesus said, you will not see me again till you say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And they will accept Jesus as their Messiah. As it says, Zechariah chapter 12, verse 10, they will mourn for the one they pierced, as one mourns for an only son. Only begotten son. And then it says in Zechariah chapter 14, he will say, you know, they will ask him, where did you receive these wounds in your hands and feet? And he says, I received them in the house of my brethren. So, brothers and sisters, they will wrestle, they've been wrestling with God and man since the very beginning, but they will overcome. As the name Israel is a prophetic name, just like Abram had his name changed from Abram to Abraham, to father of many nations, before he had any children. He had no children. He was 75 years old. His wife was 65, no children. And God said, hey, I'm changing your name to father of many nations. And then it came to pass. God calls those things that are not as if they are. Romans chapter 4. And it became so. So the same is with Israel, even though it's taken thousands of years to be fulfilled. It will be fulfilled that Israel, Jacob, and the physical man Jacob, whose name was changed to Israel, and his descendants, the sons of Israel, the children of Israel, the man, they will wrestle with God and man and overcome. Just as the man Jacob wrestled with the angel of the Lord and overcame. He overcame. So he became known as Israel, the man. As above, so below. The man Israel is a manifestation and an earthly type of what God's really doing with the whole nation of Israel. Anyway, brothers and sisters, let me go back to the pattern where I was at as I've skipped ahead. Let me go back. So they went up there and then they had the fear of the Lord came upon the people. So as above, so below, brothers and sisters. What's done on earth is, what's done in heaven is done on earth. Well, along, brothers and sisters, as I mentioned, when King Saul was anointed, it says in 1 Samuel chapter 12, the children of Israel desired a king over them. And Samuel told them, this is a wicked thing you've done. God is your king. Just like God was a king over Adam and Eve, and they rejected him. Then, you know, then Israel wrestled with God and overcame. And then his children, you know, on down through, they keep rebelling against God, rejecting God as their king. So God said, okay, you want an earthly king? I'll give you one. They got Saul. Even though King David was a man after his own heart, brothers and sisters, God never wanted an earthly king over Israel. But that's what they chose. That's what they wanted. So they wanted, they wanted an earthly king over them. But that earthly king like David, as above, so below. That's why God had to get rid of Saul. Saul was trying to do as above, so below, and follow after the pattern of Satan to rebel against God. Samuel, the prophet, came and told King Saul two or three times, hey, God said, do this, don't do this, don't do this, do this, don't do that. And every time He disobeyed and said, well, I thought this would be a better idea to do it this way than what you told me. So that's why God took the kingdom away from him, because Saul is like a type of Satan. He did what he thought was right in his own eyes. He rebelled against the commandments of God that God gave him through the prophet Samuel. He took upon himself authority he didn't have. He tried to make himself the king of kings, not just a king, but the king of kings. So God rejected him and got a man after his own heart who would do what God wanted him to do. That's King David, brothers and sisters. And so David, some of the kings of Israel followed the pattern that God wanted, as above, so below. And then most of them, as a matter of fact, the northern tribes, after King David's son was Solomon, was the next king. And then Solomon was so bad, everybody thinks, you know, Solomon, which he was wise, but he was so bad and did so many things against God. God didn't destroy Solomon for the sake of his father, the promises he made to King David. But when Solomon died, God split the kingdom into the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom. So you have those two kingdoms. Israel are the 10 tribes of, you know, the lost tribes they talk about, 10 tribes of Israel, and then Judah in the bottom. You know, it was separated. So that's why at the time of Jesus, it's Judea, because it's where the tribe of Judah was, around Jerusalem. And then the northern kingdoms, all up in northern Israel, they were taken by the Assyrians. It's like 760, whatever it is, B.C. God scattered them because of their disobedience. They never had a king that did above as below. The northern kingdom of Israel never had a single king, not one single king, who obeyed God and did God's will. Every one of them was patterned after doing the will of Satan, not the will of God. Now in the southern kingdom in Judah, some were good, from wicked King Manasseh to good kings like Hezekiah. There were several good kings in the southern kingdom. They had periods of revival, periods of downfall, periods of revival, periods of downfall, back and forth, until finally God sent them into the 70-year captivity. God saved a remnant for himself and sent them back. Our brothers and sisters, this is the thing too. When Jesus came, he was God. He was the King of Kings, and they rejected him. They rejected their king, and they chose. And that's why I don't even know what I'll call this video. God follows the patterns, and the devil follows patterns too. We can see these patterns. That's why Paul says we're not ignorant of Satan's devices. He follows patterns. God follows patterns. Satan tries to pervert and copy God's patterns. This is what I've been saying in this video. Now, when Jesus came, listen to this, brothers and sisters. Listen to this. This is what the Lord dropped on me this afternoon. When Pontius Pilate presented Jesus to Israel, what did he say? When they said, crucify him, crucify him. And Pontius Pilate said, shall I crucify your king? And he presented to him Barabbas and Jesus, who is also called King of the Jews. When they crucified him, they put above his Pontius Pilate put above the head of Jesus the truth. He put above the truth. This is Jesus Christ of Nazareth, King of the Jews. He put it in Latin, Greek, and Aramaic above Jesus' head there, or in Hebrew or Aramaic, whatever. It doesn't matter. He put it up there above there saying, this is the King of the Jews. He was the King of Israel. And they rejected him, brothers and sisters. And what did they say? And listen to this. This is what the Lord dropped on me. That's why I started to call this video, you know, a warning to Israel. It's up to the Lord. This is the point. When Pontius Pilate said, you know, shall I crucify your king? What did they say? What did they say? They said, we have one king over us, and that's Caesar. You know, their purpose, brothers and sisters, was to try to cause a riot, and they also wanted to say that politically the high priest and them were playing politics with Pontius Pilate, because Pontius Pilate, there had already been a rebellion. And the historians tell us that, you know, the Caesar had already warned Pontius Pilate, if there's any more rebellion, I'm going to chop off you. You're going to be dead. You know, I'm going to kill you. So Pontius Pilate was very afraid of some kind of a rebellion and a breach of peace and an uprising. That was the big thing in Rome. If you read in the book of Acts, we'd see where they had riots. The leaders of the city came out and begged the people, please don't do this, because we'll be in, you know, they're going to be in trouble with Caesar. The main thing that Caesar wanted in all these outlying communities in the Roman Empire, no breach of peace, no rioting, because then they're going to send in the man and they're going to send in the Roman legions, which they did, and destroyed Jerusalem in 70 AD. And that's what because of rebellion. That's the big thing Caesar was all about. So Pontius Pilate had to keep the peace at all cost. You know, and ultimately, even though his wife had a dream and warned him, do not hurt this man, you know, because I have a dream about him. God gave Pontius Pilate's wife a dream, warning her to warn her husband don't crucify Jesus. But of course, his hand was forced. That's why he washed his hands. He says, I'll wash my hands of this. May his blood's going to be on you. And they said, may his blood be on our heads and on our children's heads. That's the part they cut out of that movie, The Passion of the Christ. You know, they didn't translate that part in the subtitles because all the Jewish people that control Hollywood had a fit. Those secular Jewish people, they're not practicing Jews. They hated Jesus. They still hate Jesus. As I mentioned in videos before, go to Israel right now. Those rabbis will get in your face. They'll do to you what they did to Stephen. They'll do to you what they did to the apostles. They'll do to you what they did to Jesus, barring maybe stoning you, even though who knows. They will gnash their teeth. They will plug their ears. They will yell in your face. They will try to stone you and run you out of town if you go over there telling about Jesus. As a matter of fact, it's illegal to proselytize in Israel today and talk about Jesus. Try to evangelize people on the street. It is illegal, brothers and sisters. To me, that's a great sign that the Bible is true, just as the Word says, they've been blinded in part by God until the end times. And brothers and sisters, that's the pattern that I'm trying to tell you. They said, we have one king over us, and that's Caesar. They rejected God again and again and again. That's why God sent the Roman legions in there and destroyed the place. And just as the disciples of Jesus said, oh, look how great this place is, Matthew 24. And Jesus said, I tell you the truth, not one stone will be left on top of another. Why? Because they rejected Jesus as the Messiah, as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. That's why the verse in Isaiah 61, after he talks about the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, Jesus quotes that in Luke chapter 4. Verse 18, he says that, you know, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to set those at liberty, those who are bound, and all those things. Jesus stopped in that text. The next verse says, and declare the year of the vengeance of our God. Brothers and sisters, the year of vengeance of our God has been really upon Israel since they rejected the Messiah. The Lord gave them one generation to repent from the time of Jesus, about 33 AD until 70 AD. They had one generation to repent to stop their animal sacrifices there, which is an abomination to the blood of Jesus. And then he stopped and ended it. And they've been in the year of the vengeance of our Lord all the way till now. Now the time of the year of the vengeance of our God is about to come on the whole earth. It's called, AKA, the tribulation period. That 7-year period, as it tells us in Daniel 9:27, there's a period of 7 years coming upon the earth where all hell is going to break loose for all the world. And that's the time that God will reconcile himself with his firstborn nation of Israel. God will reconcile himself with Israel, brothers and sisters. And then they will receive the Messiah when they see him with their own eyes coming in the clouds. He'll come to Bozrah first, the Bible tells us, with blood on his garments from destroying those who would destroy the earth, the Antichrist, the false prophet, and the armies of the Gentiles. He will destroy them. Then he will appear at Bozrah, which is also Petra in modern day names, over there in Jordan. He will go there and see the nation of Israel, who is in hiding from the Antichrist. After I'm going through it, let me just go through this, just run over this sequence of events. For those of you who have not, don't know this and haven't seen my videos, what happens is, what I'm getting at, Israel will once again reject their King of Kings. And Jesus said, I come and, you know, in my Father's name, and you don't receive me, but there's one coming in his own name, and him you shall receive. Jesus was prophesying of the Antichrist. The Antichrist is coming in his own name, not in the name of the Lord. He will be received by Israel. Again, listen to a clue. Listen to the clue of who is the Antichrist. This is a word from the Lord. A clue to who is the Antichrist. The nation of Israel said at the day of the crucifixion of the Lord, before the pavement, they call the place the pavement in English, where Pontius Pilate was judging the Lord Jesus Christ. And the people said, he's not our king. We have one king over us, even Caesar. Caesar is our king. So Caesar will be their king again. They will make a deal with Caesar again, brothers and sisters, and reject the Messiah again right now at the end of the church age. So that's why, you know, I know Israelis were not going to listen. Just 1 in 1 million. 1 in 100, 1 in 10 million, whatever. There's how many millions of Jews in the world? 20 million, I think, in the whole world. Listen, brothers and sisters, it's not too late. If you just happen to be Jewish, and by the grace of God, you will listen to this video, the year of the vengeance of our Lord is ending for the nation of Israel, and it's about to start for the Gentile world. It is a tribulation, and God will go through the process of reconciling himself with Israel. But you have a chance to enter into the church right now, into the ark, That's in Arkansas. You know, I saw that too last night, brothers and sisters, that the name Arkansas starts with Ark. I know that's, I never thought about that before until just last night. Brothers and sisters, it's time to enter into the Ark. Now's the time to be in the Ark of safety, into the Lord Jesus Christ. Enter into the kingdom of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I need to make a video too about Gentiles, because I've already gone 20 minutes with this, about these denominations and how they have their own kingdoms, their own king. They've rejected the Lord as their king too. That's why the Lord is coming. You know, that's a message for the Gentiles. I guess this one is really for Israel, kind of like for the Hebrews. And then I need to make one for the Gentiles that, you know, God is sending the tribulation because most of these denominations have fallen away, brothers and sisters. They know they've rejected Jesus as their king also. And now they have another king over them, which is Satan. They're following the pattern of hell also, brothers and sisters. They've rejected the Lord. That's why they have all of these liberal denominations like Presbyterian USA and all these, and Lutherans in England and all that. They have a bar in their headquarters in England. And then not only that, they're also saying, oh, we won't do any more business with Israel. They're breaking all ties and boycotting. These are these old liberal Protestant denominations boycotting the nation of Israel, God's original people, the chosen people, the root of the tree to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob that leads us back to our God, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. They're rejecting his people, the earthly, you know, as I've been saying this whole video, the pattern on as it is in heaven, let it be done on earth. Israel is the natural manifestation of God's will. We, the church, are the spiritual manifestation of God's will. God does these things on all these levels. When you've touched Israel, the nation of Israel, you've touched the apple of God's eye. You poke God in the eye. If you mess with the church, you've also touched God's eye also. We, the church, God says, I'll bless those who bless you and I will curse those who curse you. Everyone always applies that to Israel, but they don't apply that to the church. The Bible says we are adopted children of Abraham. We, Abraham is father. That's why people say Father Abraham. He is our father. Father Abraham. We are adopted children of Abraham because we're children of faith. Romans chapter 4. We're adopted in, thereby we may cry Abba, Father, to God. So that's why a lot of people say, Father Abraham. There's a song, you know, for children, Father Abraham. He is our father, just as he is the father of the children of Israel. We're adopted children. We're the children of faith, the Gentile church. Brothers and sisters, we have a king over us. Those of you who accept Jesus Christ as king, we're in his kingdom. All these denominations that have rejected the Lord as their king, they got their own kingdoms. They're building their own denominations, their own kingdom. They're going astray, doing their own thing, just like the nation of Israel has done. Brothers and sisters, it's a time for reconciliation. It's a time for peace. It's a time and a season. There is a season. To everything, there is a season. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, you know, it's made popular by the song by the Yardbirds. To everything, turn, turn, there is a season, turn, turn. You know, that's from Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 10. It's a season, brothers and sisters, of reconciliation. It's a season to make peace with the Lord your God. It's a season to receive Yahshua HaMashiach as your Lord and Savior, as your Messiah, as your King of Kings, as your Deliverer, as your Savior, as your Healer, as your Provider, as your future, as your past, as your Lord and your God. Put your faith and trust in Yahshua HaMashiach. He is the Christ, the Messiah, the Anointed One, the Holy One of God, the Rose of Sharon, the Fairest of 10,000, the Lily of the Valley, the Balm of Gilead, that's him, Yahshua HaMashiach, the Christ, the Messiah, our Deliverer. Put your faith and trust in the finished work of Christ. Lay your burdens at the Savior's feet. Hallelujah. Turn your back on the things of this world. Turn your back on building your own kingdom. Turn your back on dead works of denominations trying to build their own kingdom and their own name. Make their own name great. So-and-so's ministry. Got their name up there in lights. Famous. You know, all of these people building their own thing. Submit yourselves under the mighty hand of God. Surrender your life unto the Lord. It's time to be delivered. It's time to come out from this world. It's time to come out from dead religion. It's time to come out from Phariseeism. It's time to be delivered from rabbinical Judaism, which is the Pharisees. That is the direct lineage to the Pharisees. The very same ones who said, we will not have this man rule over us. They rejected him, just as Jesus told the parable, Luke chapter 19. When he tells one of the parables of the talents, he said there was a man that was given a kingdom and he was sent into a far land to gather to get his kingdom. And then he told his subjects in the place when he left, he said, he gave them talents. And then when he left, some of the servants said, we will not have this man rule over us. So when the king returns, When Jesus returns, he said those who did the things with the talents, he would reward them based on what they did with the talents. The more you did, the more the Lord would reward you. That's for us, the church. For those who are Christians, he rewards us off of the works that we do. Then he goes to say about those who said, we will not have this man rule over us. That's the nation of Israel. He said, bring those enemies of mine here and slay them before me. Those who would refuse to have me rule over them. Luke chapter 19. The Lord is going to destroy his enemies. He's going to cast them into the lake of fire. Brothers and sisters, this stuff is not a joke. It's not symbolic. It is literal that the Lord will literally bring a judgment. He is the judge. And it says, will not the Lord of the earth do right? Will he not judge right? Righteousness and justice are the foundation of his thrones. God will judge in righteousness and holiness. May you be found in Christ. May you be found worthy in Christ. Luke 21 verse 36. May you be found worthy in Christ. Call upon the name of the Lord while he may be found. Repent of your sins. Turn from this world. Turn from false religion. Turn from dead religion. Turn to the living God. The Lord is alive. He said, I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Just as when Sadducees, they're sad, you see, because they don't believe in the resurrection. They're sad, you see. And they came to Jesus and asked him a trick question, tried to trick him of a man, you know, a woman who had married seven brothers and none of them had any children with her. When they got to heaven, whose wife would she be? And the people even missed the whole point of that text. The biggest point in that text, he was talking to Sadducees who believe when you die, that's it. Soul sleep. They believe when you die, that's it. There's no resurrection. You just cease to exist. That's what they believe. It's not about whether angels get married in heaven and all that. The focus of the text is there false doctrine? He said, you are in air. I'm sorry, you are in air. What did God say to Moses from the burning bush? That's the focus of the text. He didn't say, I was a God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and now they're dead. He didn't tell Moses, oh, I was a God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. I was, because they're dead now. This was, Abraham lived about 2200 BC. You know, this is when Moses was like 500 years later, 400 years later, 450 years later. He's talking to Moses. And he's saying, I am, not was, I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. That's the point. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob are alive. And God is outside time. He is eternally I am to everybody and every day and every time, yesterday, today, and forever. God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He's unchanging, unmutable is the big theology term they use. He's immutable. God never changes. He's omnipresent. That means he's everywhere. He's omnipotent. He's all-powerful. He is, what is it that I just said? He is all-knowing, all immutable. He's unchanging. That's our God. He's unchanging. He's unmovable. Immutable is the word. He's all-knowing, all-seeing. He's everywhere, above and below. In all of creation, God is there. He is I am. He's steadfast, immovable in all things. So we are called to follow the pattern above that is below. That's why the Bible tells us to be steadfast and unmovable, to be like our King, to follow your King, to be like your God. So let me end with this, brothers and sisters. Because I had a vision a long time ago in the Philippines. I was fasting and praying with all the preachers in this town trying to bring revival. And I saw a vision of these two angels, brothers and sisters. They were pushing wheelbarrows. And they stopped these wheelbarrows and they were shoveling out gold. And it was like, you know, melted and they were smashing it, making it into a road. And then I saw these other angels coming blowing trumpets. And then I saw like the Lord was being carried on a throne, like one of, you know, they used to carry those people on thrones. I saw the Lord off in the distance as he was being carried on a throne, and those trumpet blasters were blasting. They were all angels. And the Lord said, you know, and the Lord told me at that time, he said, that when a king arrives, you know, like in the old days and even now in England, those countries, when a king is coming, there's people that go ahead of the king and say, hey, the king is coming. They blow trumpets. They clear the road. They lay down a red carpet, all those different things, and get everything ready for the king to come. They say, hey, the king is coming to the town today. Everybody get ready, clean everything up. Here comes the king. He's on his way. Get all the garbage out of the road. Get all the junk out of your house. Clean everything up because the king might come to your house. He might stop and say, hey, I want to drink a cup of coffee with Joe Citizen right here, Joe Subject of his kingdom. Right here, I want to stop and drink coffee at his house and talk to him about what he thinks about the kingdom. You know, tell me what needs to be done in this town. You never know where the king might show up. But you know when that you hear the trumpet blast and you see the way being prepared. Hey, you got to get ready, get cleaned up, put on your good clothes and be ready, stand at attention. Oh, here comes the king. Brothers and sisters, that's the message of the Lord to his people. You know, we need to be going ahead and trumpeting and preparing the way for the return of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. We need to prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. And, you know, me as a preacher, that's what I'm here for, to tell you, the people, clean up your house. Get your house in order. Put on your white garments. Take off them old filthy stinking clothes you've been wearing and put on righteousness. Put on righteousness. Put on the clean clothes of the Lord's righteousness. Get yourself ready. Clean up your house. Turn from your wicked ways. Get all the yeast out of your house and get prepared to meet the Lord your God. For the kingdom of heaven is at hand. God bless you, brothers and sisters. I love you all in the Lord. Thanks to all of help with Joshua's ministry. Thank the Lord, you know, as by the grace of God, before he returns, or if he doesn't return, in the imminent future, we're going to build another orphanage at the end of the year. God bless you guys. I thank you for all your prayers, all of your help with the orphanages and the feeding programs, and all the things that the Lord would have me do to bring repentance to his people here before his return, here in the United States and wherever else the Lord would send me. God bless you guys, as the Lord has reminded me. He's going to send me to all these places. So I don't know when the rapture is going to be, but I'm going to go and keep going and keep working while the sun is shining. The sun's going down. And Jesus said, darkness is coming and no man can work. Today's the day to make hay while the sun is shining, brothers and sisters. God bless you guys. Make some hay. Get busy. Do God's will. Malachi 3:10. God says, you know, try me. Test me. You know, bring in your offerings and see if I won't open up heaven and pour out the blessings that you cannot contain. You cannot outgive God, brothers and sisters. He will make a way. And give God everything. I'm not talking about just you're not talking about just tithing and things like that. I'm talking about your time, your love, your energy to praise and worship, read the Bible, go minister to other people, tell people about Jesus, proclaim his return, and give of all things that you have. Give freely, have you received, freely give. Give. You cannot give God. Give everything you've got to God now. Everything you've got. Give it. Give your life to God, including everything. That's including your finances. Give all you have to God. It all belongs to him anyway. Store up your treasure in heaven and not on earth. God bless you guys.